Welcome into Forest Glen Park. It's game two of the doubleheader between the Huntington Foresters and the Grace College Lancers. Already one down here after a really nice play by Cade Flores at short. And now Graham Collin has a full count on Friesma, the shortstop for Grace, as he delivers the payoff pitch and hits the outside corner for a called third strike. Fastball. Command has been good here in the first inning as he's retired the first two hitters.
Yeah, we were just talking that play that Cade made, ranging to his left up the middle, fielded the ball on a short hop, and then threw across his body to first base to get one of the speediest guys on Grace's team, maybe the best. Really nice play.
It was.
Really nice play.
Big time play, because he was where he is about right now. The ball was hit towards the middle. Mm-hmm. As you mentioned, roamed over and threw out De Leon, who's one of the fastest in all of the league even. I mean, just a speedy runner. Collin delivers. It's fouled away by Danforth as the count is still 0-2. Huntington beat down Grace in that first game, 19-3 final. Papp and Brock delivered a great start. They're looking for their ace to deliver again. Delivers that. Another one up the middle for Flores. Another nice pick. Throw over is high, and that sails into the dugout. That'll be an E6 as Danforth will head up to second base, I believe. Yep, there he goes. So, once again, Flores showing off the range. That time, just couldn't get the throw on target.
Yeah, that was a little bit more of a routine play. Mm-hmm. He did have to come and get it on a short hop. But you could tell as soon as the ball was out of his hand, it was going to be high.
Here's the pitch. Carr takes low. Foresters line it up the exact same way as they did in game one. Wolf, Flores, Paulina, Malott. I guess I should say there is one change. Coons, the catcher here in game two. Collin delivers. That's in there for a strike. And, of course, the new pitcher, Graham Collin, on the mound. But in the outfield, it remains the same as well. Nolasco, Baroa in left. Deckman in center. Rost in right. Danforth, the left fielder for this team, is over at second after the E6 on Flores. Now at the plate is the second baseman, Carr. Waiting on deck is Hartley, who hit a three-run bomb, accounted for the only three runs Grace scored in game one. Collin sets and delivers. Ground ball left side, foul. It's 2-2. Collin, his last time out, not his best start, but still good enough. Seven innings pitch, five hits, three earned, five walks, seven Ks. The pitch. Breaking ball in there. Called strike three. Two strikeouts looking for the Lancers in that inning. Graham gets off to a nice start. See if the bats pick him up. On to the bottom of the first. Thank you. Back here at Forest Glen Park, a scoreless top of the first for Graham Cullen, the ace for the Foresters. And now the Grace Lancers will lean on their ace. It's Evan Etchison, who will get the start. He's 5-3 with a 6.93 ERA this year. Really talented arm for Coach Roth and his side. Righty will get a chance to try to shut down this Forester offense that was absolutely scorching hot in game one of the doubleheader. And it all started with this man, Bryce Deckman, at the plate. Etchison's first pitch is popped up foul. See if anyone has room. It doesn't look like it, and that'll fall out of play. Strike number one. Yeah, outfielders for Grace remain very shallow. Danforth in left, DeLeon with good speed in center, Hickman in right. And around the horn in the infield is Callaway, Friesma, Carr, Stark. This one's lifted to the right side. Might be playable over and up against the fence. Did he catch it? No, he did not. Another foul ball as Hickman runs out of room. And then doing the catching, Sean Gannon once again with Etchison on the mound.
Well, that can be a real dangerous play because you're running full speed and the ball drops just on the other side of the fence. Yeah. And so
run out of room quickly down the right field line. Kind of cuts in towards the right fielder. Thankfully, he didn't get injured. Slammed on the brakes in time. Here's the pitch. That one's outside.
Several years ago, we were playing Spring Arbor, and a guy dove headfirst into that fence down there to catch a ball, hit his head on a pole, and had a significant concussion. We had to bring the EMS down here. And
oh my gosh.
Yeah.
2-2 now. Yeah, you got to be careful. There's a couple of spots in the park where you run out of room quickly down the left field line as well.
Yeah.
Quite literally run through a brick wall down the left field line. Down the right field line, got the fencing that's hit hard up the middle. Etchison able to deflect it. It's a good thing he did because right there to field it was Carr. That one will technically go 1-4-3.
That's a base hit if the pitcher doesn't deflect it right at the second baseman, because I think it's hit hard enough it's going to get through the infield.
Yeah, especially on the turf surface. Yeah. Probably would have skipped through or at least made, you know, Carr make an amazing play. Etchison made it more routine. So good hands by him. First down, and now Nolasco Baroa steps up. He had a great first game in this doubleheader. Was on base every single time he stepped up. Scored a handful of runs. Had a great game. Breaking ball, called strike.
You know, I think that's a big deal because it seems to me, without any data to back it up, that when he hits, Huntington has a good chance to win.
Takes a close one there. It's 2-1. Yeah, kind of cementing the lineup a little bit when you get more production from your two-hole hitter. And they got some in that last game, but they got production from a lot of different guys. Here's the pitch. That's another breaking ball. Just out of the zone. Three and one. Etchison ready to roll. His pitch popped up out of play, and the count goes full. Three balls and two strikes. So you talked about how you like Etchison. You think he's a really great pitcher. What do you think he does well that kind of keeps hitters off balance?
Well, I think he's got enough velocity that if you're sitting on the fastball, that the curveball is tough to adjust to, or vice versa. He seems to be in the strike zone, you know, quite often. I was a little surprised at his ERA for this year. Sometimes that's elevated because of early season things, you know, the schedule that you play early against really good competition. You have one bad inning, it really balloons that ERA.
Baroa staying alive, having a good at bat. still full. Now I remember Etchison last year in the Crossroads League tournament being a really solid pitcher.
Mm-hmm.
And he's had good performances this year again. So definitely the stopper for this Grace pitching staff. The full count pitch hit into shallow center field, but now going back on it, De Leon able to camp under it and make the grab. And that's two up, two down as Barrero is retired. And that'll bring up Matt Wolf.
See, that's a good example of what Atkinson can do because Barroa just missed that.
Yeah.
You know, got in on his hands a little bit. So kind of sneaky fast. So
he'll have a chance to face Matt Wolf now, who ended his game one in a positive way. Hit a two-run double off the left field wall. Here's the pitch. Check swing, foul ball. Counts 0-1. Matt Wolf just seems to be a magnet for the baseball. He's always getting hit. Fouling pitches off on check swings. Stands very close to the plate as that one's out wide. It's 1-1.
See, now the flags in left field are blowing towards left field.
Yeah, kind of switching up on
us.
See what that does to the baseball here in game two. Wolf able to check his swing, it looks like, but they're not even going to ask for an appeal.
No, the home plate umpire called it a strike.
Yeah. It's 1-2. Here's the pitch. Wolf swings and misses. It's a 1-2-3 inning, and that takes us to the second. No runs. Graham Collin back on the mound when we come back. Back here at Mike Frame Field, I'm Preston Usman alongside the longtime skipper, Mike Frame, on the air with us today. And Huntington won game one, looking for a doubleheader sweep today. They'll be back in action on Monday for two more against this same Grace Lancers squad. They've got their ace, Graham Collin, working into his second inning right now. Here's his first pitch. It's a ball against Grant Hartley, who had a nice game in game one, one of the few positive spots for the Lancers. Hit a three-run homer, was on via a double another time, a lot with a decent feed to Collin, who was able to cover.
Yeah, Graham had to turn into an athlete there, yeah. which he is a good athlete, but that was not the greatest of tosses.
Yep.
And
it was a little low, and Collin was able to pick it up. As now Stark will be the second man up in the inning as he looks at a first pitch fastball in there for strike one. Ryan Stark, first baseman in both games here today. He had a throwing error in game one as Collin misses up too tall. Count moves to 1-1. The pitch, too low. Huntington's coaching staff must have some information on these hitters because they are shifting with each batter in the infield. You can see here again, Coach, the very far left, the left side of the infield kind of swung around almost like a modified shift, leaving the middle of the field wide open. Popped up, see who takes charge. It's going to be the second baseman as Flores and Paulina battled over that one. Paulina puts it away.
Yeah, Coach Mokma and Coach Weaver do a good job of scouting report. They meet before the game with the whole team and go over tendencies, and then Mike meets with the pitching staff kind of separately to talk about some things. So they do a good job with maybe not a tremendous amount of data.
Yeah.
You're kind of going with tendencies and that kind of thing.
I mean, look how far Flores here is again in the hole. I mean, he is very close to Matt Wolf, and then Wolf still stays right on the line. Yeah. So something's telling him that Gannon pulls the ball on the ground often. They're leaving the middle of the infield wide open. This is hit to the left side. Going to be a tricky play. Flores going back hard on it and able to make a nice catch. That is a quick 1-2-3 inning as Flores once again shows off the glove. We'll be right back. It's Jordan Malott who will lead us off in the bottom of the second. Back here for the bottom of the second. No runs scored for either side yet, as we've got a matchup between two aces in this game, and it'll be Jordan Malott who leads things off for the Foresters. And man, he had an incredible game one. Three extra base hits, two doubles, a three-run homer, and a single. He was lights out in game one at the plate. And you've talked about it several times on air already. This guy was a walk-on that came into this program. And, you know, you guys weren't sure if he'd get a chance. And he got, you guys gave him one, and it's worked out. So,
well, I guarantee he's not a walk-on now.
Yeah. So. Hitting right in the heart of this order. That's outside. It's 1-2. Always cool to hear stories like that. Someone that works so hard and find success, and that's what Jordan Malott has done. Here's the pitch, fouled away.
So far, it looks like he's throwing his fastball away to hit to right-handed hitters.
I think it's another example of maybe a Grace pitcher not having complete control of their breaking ball quite yet. Going to be one of those in-betweeners again down the right field line, and once again running out of room is Hickman. So the count holds at 1-2. Here's the pitch. Fouled away again.
Yeah, all those pitches have been away from Jordy. See if he can make an adjustment.
Haven't seen him hit the ball the other way yet today. Pulled the ball hard. Seemed like every time up his first time around. Here's the pitch. Fouled away again. At least you know he's going to give you a good at bat every time up there.
Yeah.
Doing that right now, staying alive against a tough pitcher. Count holds at one ball and two strikes, making Etchison throw a lot of pitches. Here's another one. That one's down too low, and now the count evens up at two balls and two strikes. Seems like Grace is using that number system where you look down at the wristband to see what pitch to deliver. Malott pulls another one left field. This is going to be in between the two outfielders. De Leon takes over right in front of the track and puts away Malott. Hits another deep fly ball. That time just stays in the park, and it's the first out of the inning.
Well, Grace has that system where the pitcher has looks like a watch on his left hand. Really, all the players do. And a coach signals in what the pitch is.
Yeah.
And so everybody knows what the pitch is on the field.
It almost seems like a quarterback type play sheet in a way on his wrist. First pitch to Clarkson, down too low. And I think a lot of schools have gone to that. And I know the softball team as well uses a similar system. So once again, just another way that baseball's kind of changed in a way. Clarkson lifts this left side, coming in on it is the left fielder, that is Danforth, who puts it away. So two fly ball outs and two quick outs to start this inning.
Well, the system, it's a really good system. The problem is it's like $20,000.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's very, very expensive.
Never knew that.
But I know Taylor used that. Grace is using it.
Here's the pitch, hit hard, left side on the ground. This is going to be a quick play from the shortstop and a perfect throw in time by Friesma. And once again, it's 1-2-3 for HU. They scored a lot in the first game. Right now, they're stuck in a pitcher's duel. Graham Collin back out on the mound. Back here at Forest Glen Park, it's Graham Collin on the mound for inning number three, and he'll be facing off against Callaway, the third baseman for the Grace Lancers today. First pitch from Graham is in there, a high strike. Hickman, the right fielder, waits on deck. We've seen a couple batters turn around and question some of these called strikes. Callaway, another one of them.
Yeah, I don't know how long the umpire is going to tolerate that, because you're right, there have been some questions.
Collin from the windup delivers. That's a good breaking ball. That's what you wanted to see right there.
Yeah, I want to see that slider have a little bit more bite on it.
That one had lots of it. Here's the 1-2. Hit up the middle. Roaming over, Paulina picks it up, takes his time, delivers by a couple of steps in time to retire Callaway. And that's a good sign for Graham as well. He's obviously a big strikeout guy, but if he can be pitch efficient, you always take that. Now it'll be the right fielder, Hickman.
Yeah, I've been impressed with Grace and how they can put the ball in play.
Now the defense has been pretty sharp today for HU as well. They've had to be heads up and on their toes, and so far they have really done a nice job picking up their pitchers who are throwing a ton of strikes. Here's the pitch. That is in there. Called strike. It's 2-1. Hickman, who batted ninth the first game, was on several times. Walked in the nine-hole spot against Papenbrock twice. So that's fouled out of play. It's 2-2.
Yeah, we'll see if we can get the nine-hole hitter out here.
Here comes the pitch. Colin throws a breaking ball too low, and now it's a full count. There's just something about Hickman. It's tough to get out, I guess.
He really is.
Fouled away.
Another good at-bat.
Yep. Colin gets the ball right back, and he's ready to roll. Here comes the pitch. Breaking ball hit hard left side, coming in on it and making a sliding grab for the out was Nolasco Baroa. Looked like he was going to catch it standing up, but instead went down to a slide and made the catch.
It's another situation where the plate umpire has to make that call.
Yeah.
And he's getting out as far as he can. He's doing all the right things, but that is just a tough call for him to make.
Yep.
In that situation. So
it is. That one a little easier for the field umpire as it goes 5-3. Matt Wolf with a great throw across the diamond. And that takes us already to the bottom of the third. Solid inning for Graham Collin. Welcome back for the bottom of the third. We're tied at 0-0 between the Grace Lancers and the Huntington Foresters. We knew it probably wouldn't be the same type of game as game one, and we're kind of getting exactly what we expected. It's a pitcher's duel between Etchison and Collin. Sebastian Coons will lead us off in the bottom of the third. He's starting to swing a hot bat. As he takes first pitch breaking ball in there for a strike.
Yeah, last couple outings, he's looked a lot better at the plate.
Hit a home run in his last game here against IUPUC. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. I always get confused on that one. And then he actually homered in his last home game as well in that second game of the doubleheader against Taylor. So he's homered in back-to-back ball games in this park. 1-2, as that was a close take.
Yeah, I don't know if you take that pitch.
Yeah.
Because he's been ringing people up.
He sure has. It's 1-2. Here's the pitch. Swing and a miss. Gets him anyways. And that's the first out of the inning. Etchison has faced the minimum so far. 7 up, 7 down. That'll bring up Paco Paulina. He was hitless in game one. Trying to still find that rhythm at the plate. Takes first pitch strike. Delivery up too high. It's 1-1.
Yeah, I'm not sure I would be taking a lot of pitches against Atkinson. He throws strikes. He's around the plate.
This one's lifted in play right side. Shallow fly ball. Hickman gets underneath it and puts it away. And I'm telling you what, he is dialed in right now on the mound. He's faced eight, and it's all been out. So that'll allow Cade Flores to step up. Freshman having a tremendous campaign. Had another nice game one. Has already made a nice defensive play here in game two. We'll see if he can get this offense going. First pitch in there, called strike. The 0-1. Grounded up the middle. This is right at the shortstop. Friesma gets the high hop, makes the throw over. It's another 1-2-3 inning. Nine up, nine down, as Graham Collins will have to keep the Grace Lancers right there when we come back for the top of the fourth. Back for the top of the fourth, still 0-0 as Graham Collin and Etchison continue to go out for out. And it's Graham's turn to match it as he steps up for his fourth inning of work. He'll be taking on the shortstop Friesma, who is 0-1 today with a backwards K. Collin works from the windup and delivers. First pitch, breaking ball, called a strike. Collin gets the sign, and here comes the delivery. Breaking ball lifted into shallow center. Deckman broke back and now stops in his tracks and makes the grab. Kind of looks like a panic there for a moment for Deckman, but thankfully it was hit right at him.
I think he may have slipped. That's the wettest part of the outfield is out there, so that may be what happened.
Of course, a lot of rain over the last several days here in Huntington. Couple of flood warnings throughout the last couple of weeks as well. Here's the pitch from Collin, up too high. It's 1-0. This is Danforth, his first time up, reached on that E6 by the shortstop Flores. Takes a called strike at the bottom of the zone to even up the count. Collin with the kick and the delivery. That's too low. Two balls and a strike. Graham works so quick out there. Here comes the next pitch outside. Now three balls and a strike. See if he can get back in the zone. Good hitter Danforth at the plate. The pitch fouled away.
Well, that was a real defensive swing.
Yeah. I don't know. It looked like it could have been down out of the zone, but it evens up the count. It's full. Here's the pitch. Hit hard left side. Wolf down on his stomach again. The runner out of the box barely moving in Danforth. And he's thrown out. I mean, he was.
He almost acts like something.
Yeah, I wonder if he's hurt. Because he was not out of the box hard at all. So something to keep an eye on. That could have been a hit, I think.
Nice play with Matt down there. I think he still would have got him because the ball was hit hard. But
it was just interesting because you could just tell he wasn't getting down the line hard at all. So I guess we'll see if he sticks in the game defensively as the count's 1-1 here. The hitter is Austin Carr, and that one just missed low. Two balls and a strike. Carr is 0-for-1 with a strikeout back in the first inning. It was a strikeout looking, and now the count's 2-2. Collin about to deliver his 50th pitch. Here it comes. Hit left side. Wolf has it again. Up with it. A little more routine, and the throw is perfect. Collin is through four scoreless. Forrester's back to the plate, flying through game number two. Back here for the bottom of the fourth. Both teams without a hit so far in this game. And let's see if the Foresters maybe can get something going offensively, as it'll be Bryce Deckman, the leadoff man, who gets things started here in the fourth. Well, in the last game he had 5 at-bats and 5 innings. It doesn't look like, obviously, that's possible here in game two. He might only get 3.
Yeah.
So. See if he can take advantage of number two, though, as Etchison starts with a fastball up too tall and then tries a breaking ball that is fouled off. It's 1-1. This might be a game you talked about it during breaks, that you think about playing some small ball once you get a runner on base.
Yeah.
Of course, you also said you got to get someone on base first. Neither team has done that very well to start this game. And that, of course, is a credit to the pitcher on both sides. The pitch, breaking ball.
Grace's pitcher seems like everything's away, fastball, breaking ball. So Huntington's going to have to make an adjustment to make him come in.
See if someone can do that. Deckman would be a great start here as it's 2-2. Takes another tough breaking ball down. It's now full.
Yeah, everything is away. Yep.
That's been especially the miss with that breaking ball, too. Seems like it's always away from the righty, almost in the left-handed batter's box. Pitch, breaking ball, swing and a miss. It's nice to know you got confidence in that pitch when you need it, though. I mean,
yeah, he made Bryce look bad there.
Yeah.
Totally fooled him.
So that's Baroa who steps up now. First time up, Gregory hit a line drive for an out to left field. He's up in the count 1-0. Etchison, always working from the stretch, delivers a good breaking ball in there for a strike. 1-1. Don't have to worry about the pitch clock in this game. Both pitchers are getting the ball and working. Hit up the middle, has eyes. De Leon's going to have to pull up, and that's going to fall in for a hit. And you can see Etchison turning to the dugout immediately, throwing his hands up. I think he thought De Leon should have gone after that ball. Not what you would necessarily want to see out of your starting pitcher, though. I mean, immediately he turned to the dugout and threw his hands up as if that ball could have been caught.
But the ball, the center fielder fielded it on, what, 2 bounces?
Yeah.
So I'm not sure he's going to be able to get to that to make a play. Maybe I'm wrong.
And not only that, if he does dive and it gets by him, you're looking at three bases potentially.
Yeah.
And in this game, that's a big deal.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Wolf up now, takes first pitch, breaking ball top of the zone for a called strike. Etchison works through his signs and gets the set, delivers. Wolf hits it hard to right center field. That gets down in front of the right fielder, Hickman. And now two on with one out. That was a great piece of hitting by Matt Wolf.
Surely was, yeah. I think that's when he's at his best, when he's hitting the ball to the shortstop's left. So left center field over to right field. Means he's staying on the ball. A good, really good swing.
Yeah, it was a great swing. He put together some better swings at the end of game one. And now here in game two, he's got another. That allows Jordan Mellott to come up, who's already had a great day. So Etchison now working with runners on. First time he's really been in any sort of trouble. First pitch, Mellott. Big hack. Comes up empty.
Yeah, a game like this, you just don't know how many chances you're going to get. So you gotta have a sense of urgency to get it done when you get a chance.
Pick off behind the runner at second. Baroa able to dive back in. Yeah, it feels like, and maybe we're wrong, and of course we've jinxed several players already on our broadcast together, but you feel like you get one or two and you like your chances with Graham Collin. And the same will be said with Grace's team as well.
Yeah, no doubt.
0-2. Mellott has the entire right side of the infield wide open. If he can decide to let that ball travel like you talked about, shoot it through the right side, the Foresters might find themselves in front. Another pickoff.
Yeah, ground ball to second base. It's a base hit.
Yep. No one there. Clarkson waits on deck. Now Etchison works a little slower with the runners on. Breaking ball lifted into center field. De Leon able to run in. He's going to settle under it, make the grab. Now two down. Clarkson and the Foresters will have to go with two.
See, once again, an example of he's throwing everybody away. That's a breaking ball away, but we try to pull it. And we hit a weak fly ball to left center field. Instead of going with the pitch, like I said, that's going to... We'll see if they make that adjustment. So far, they haven't.
Yep, the only one that seems to have made that adjustment
is Wolf.
Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
Shot it the other way, and he hit it hard, too.
Yep.
We'll see if Cam Clarkson can come up with a big swing here. At this point, not really early in this game, just a seven-inning game, so you're getting closer and closer to the end of this ball game already with how quickly both pitchers have been working. They pretty much play Cam straight up. Pickoff play again. Baroa back safely. They're keeping a close eye on him.
Well, he runs a lot, so that may be obviously what they're thinking. I don't know if you run here with Clarkson up.
Yeah. Don't really have the hitter to protect him on the right side of the batter's box as well. So, you know, and Clarkson's got a good bat, and he's up 2-0. See if Cam can make it happen. We all know the power Cam possesses. Right now, you just take a base hit. Here's it, 2-0, right on the outside corner. Two balls and a strike.
It's just me, but I think that's a good take. That's a fastball on the corner, and I don't know what you're going to do with that.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, you're in charge in that 2-0 count. You might as well hit a pitch that you can hit hard.
Yeah.
All right, 3-1. Same scenario. Clarkson looking to do damage. There goes the runner, and it's fouled away. So now it's full. We know the runners will be off. As there's two outs here in the bottom of the fourth. Clarkson waits. Etchison sets. Here is another pickoff play. I guess just to keep him close, but at this point, I think a base hit's going to score him no matter what.
Yeah.
With the runner going. Etchison will need to lock in on Clarkson. Cam trying to come up with a big knock. Here's the pitch. Clarkson hits it hard, but foul.
He came in there.
Yes, he did.
Came in with the fastball. Got it in on his hands enough. That's about all Cam's going to do with that ball.
Yep.
Just hit it foul there.
It's a good piece of pitching. I mean, he's been spot on with his location. Gets the sign again. Good battle going on. See who wins it. Here's the pitch. Clarkson swings and misses. It's blocked behind the plate. And the throw from Gannon in time. So Clarkson can't deliver. Still no runs in this game as we head to the fifth. Top of five in game number two. Graham Collin so far has been rock solid on the mound. He'll have a chance to keep this one scoreless as he's taking on the Grace Lancers for the first time this season. Graham just two strikeouts so far, pitching to a lot of contact. He'll be facing Grant Hartley. Steps up to the plate. He's 0 for 1. Collin from the windup delivers a first pitch foul ball strike. Hartley, his first time up, grounded out to the first baseman, and Collin made a tremendous play. Good catch. Collin from the windup delivers another great pitch. That's a swing and a miss.
That's a good pitch. I think that's a changeup.
Perfectly located. Collin works quick again. Here comes the 0-2. Swing and a miss. Good morning, good afternoon, good night.
There you go.
Yep. Not much thought about that. He just went right at him. You got to love that from your ace, though. Someone that's going to dial it up and just be like, here you go, hit it if you can.
Well, Graham, somebody, too, that he can smell the end zone. You know, if he's got a lead going late in the game, then you know, he's gonna want to go close it out right away.
Well, there's another one pitch out for Stark. He pops it up, and now it's Gannon. That'll bring up, Gannon's at the plate now. He popped up to the shortstop his first time, 0 for 1. The pitch is down low, 1-0. And just an update on Collin. He's at 57 pitches, so still just hanging right in there. As that one's outside, it's now two balls and no strikes. Graham gets the sign and delivers. That's in there for a strike. 2-1. Collin's pitch. On the outside corner. It's now 2-2. payoff pitch. Breaking ball, swing and a miss. Colin locked in right now. He's retired now 12 straight as we head to the bottom of the fifth. Someone's got a score in this one. See if it's the Foresters coming up next. Back here in a great second game, nothing to nothing. And Evan Etchison's back on the mound. Both pitchers right now dialing it up. It'll be Dylan Rost who gets us started. Here in the fifth, it's a breaking ball in there for a strike. If I could keep track, I would, but it seems like the first pitch strike percentage is high for both these guys right now, getting ahead of hitters. That one's out wide. It's 1-1. Coons on deck. He'll be followed by Paco Paulina. There have been two combined hits in this game, both by the Lancers. The pitch fouled away. Excuse me, both by the Foresters, by the way. The Lancers do not have a hit. Their only base runner goes back to that Cade Flores error in the first. Here's the pitch. Breaking ball up the middle softly. It's going to have to be a quick play, and because of that, it's a mistake made by Friesma. Probably going to be an E6. He could have made that play, but Rost did put the pressure on, and that's a base runner. That's a good way to start an inning. All right. So you were the head coach for a long time. Are you bunting in this situation, or are you letting Sebastian swing away?
Well, the problem with bunting in this situation is it's not something that Sebastian does well.
Yep.
That's why I looked to the dugout to see if Thad might bring somebody up to hit for him to bunt. Ethan Haney is a really good bunter.
Here's the pitch. Coons is looking to bunt. He bunts right through it for strike one.
Yeah, that's my point right there.
Yeah, we'll see if they
not
keep
a,
it on.
Not a situation that you like to be in.
Yep.
The guy at the plate just doesn't handle the bat real well.
Pickoff throw. Getting back in time is Ross. Etchison really taking some time with runners on base. He was very quick for a while, but now making sure he gets everything right. Coons takes a pitch just outside. It's a
yeah,
pretty
he,
good pitch.
He slows down, to your point. He slows down quite a bit with runners on base.
Yeah, which I understand. He wants to throw his best stuff here in this game because you can't give up anything right now to either side.
Yeah.
Here's the pitch. Coons pops it straight up. Looks like it should be playable. I guess we'll see. And it falls off the top of the dugout, so I guess not, as Stark was given his best effort.
The other thing that Sebastian isn't great at is hitting the ball the other way, and that's what this is going to demand, especially at this point with two strikes.
1-2, right side wide open. Coons mostly pulls the ball hard. I've seen that several times already this season in this park. It's pulled a couple balls over the left field wall. That'd be a big boost at the moment. Etchison just not giving up a whole lot right now, though. He sets from the stretch. Throws over again. Righty sets again. At the waist, delivers. Swing and a miss. Snap throw down to first. Not in time. Coons is out on strikes. And Rost will stay right there first. That's one down, and now Paco Polina steps up. That's the fifth strikeout on the day for the Grace Lancers ace. He's had his best stuff this afternoon. First pitch to Paulina. Big sweeping pitch away from him. Paulina kind of takes a big step at the baseball when he's ready to load. I feel like he's a guy that is capable of hitting a ball through the right side. But as we mentioned, just hasn't swung the bat as well as he'd like this season. No better time to come up with a big hit. There goes the runner, and it's fouled into the Forrester dugout. Counts 1-1.
Yeah, when you're not swinging the bat well, you have a tendency to want to go out and get the ball out in front of the plate to kind of jump at it a little bit because you don't have confidence in staying back and trust in your hands. And I think Paco's kind of in that situation right now.
Of course, if you're doing that, it makes it awfully hard to hit it the other way.
Yeah, that's my point with both him and Sebastian. I'm just not sure these guys are going to have to make adjustment because it's not a good matchup.
Yep. Etchison delivers, swing and a miss.
See, he's just way out in front.
Yep.
Instead of staying back and letting the ball get deep, and if he can learn how to do that, he could be a really good player.
Yeah. See if he can make an adjustment mid at bat. Another throw over. No limit here.
Yeah.
He'd be well over it. The pitch. That's just off the plate. That looks like one of the better pitches we've seen today.
Surprised that wasn't a strike.
Yeah. So it's 2-2. Ross still on first after that leadoff error. One of these teams going to have to come out victorious. But right now, both offenses just can't find any sort of rhythm as that's fouled straight back. 2-2. Cade Flores will be the next hitter. I think this would be a good pitch to run on. I don't know if you agree or not, but 2-2 count, some speed at first. I wouldn't be surprised to see it, I guess.
Yeah. Certainly an opportunity to throw a breaking ball to the hitter, which is ideally, you know, off-speed pitch. You want to run on that breaking ball changeup.
Yep. See if they're thinking the same thing. Nope. Hit up the middle. This could be two. Shortstop steps on the bag. Throw across in time. That one goes from Friesma to Stark. Just like that, a 6-3 double play ends the threat. That's the end of five. We head to the six. Graham Collin coming back on the mound. Thank you. Back here for the top of the sixth, Graham Collins so far really solid. Five innings, four strikeouts, no walks, only one base runner against him. That was an E6 all the way back in the first. Since then, he has retired. Let me do the math really quick. 3, 6, 9, 12, 13 in a row. So he has been solid, and really was even solid in that first because it shouldn't have been a base runner. First pitch, looking to bunt for a hit. Maybe not a bad idea from Callaway. It's called a strike. At this point, these coaches start thinking, in what way can we scratch a run across? Maybe bunting for a hit's not the worst idea. And now it's 0-2.
Yeah, neither team has really attempted that except for this hitter. Huntington's not attempted a bunt for a hit all day.
Pitch. Breaking ball, swing and a miss. That is a three-pitch strikeout again. Collin looks pretty locked in at the moment. Strikeout number 5 on the afternoon. So that'll bring up the 9-hole hitter, Hickman. Graham from the windup delivers. He's looking to bunt as well. It's called a ball. 1-0 count.
Yeah, Wolf has kind of taken that away. He's creeps in front of that third base bag as the pitch is being made.
Looking to do it again. It's called a ball again. It's 2-0. So maybe even just throwing off the rhythm of Collin a little bit is the approach.
Once again, the 9-hole hitter can't seem to throw strikes to.
There's one. But you're right. He's been up in the count every single time he stepped up to the plate today. 2-1 pitch. This time he does bunt it. It's going to be a fair ball, I believe. No, they called it foul. I thought that Coons actually went out and touched it in fair territory.
It was tough to see because he was blocking us, but I think the ball must have spun back into foul territory.
That was a funky play.
I think Sebastian was going out to get it
before
it went foul.
What was strange was Hickman didn't respond out of the box at all.
Yeah.
Kind of just stood there.
Yeah.
And I thought Coons was getting up there to – I thought Coons was getting out there to field it and then throw him out, but
– yeah, that's what I thought too.
Didn't happen that way. Full count. Collin needs to dial up a strike here. He does. It's fouled away. Coons gives it a look. Will not have room, and it stays full.
Got to throw strikes here.
Yep.
Got to make him hit his way on.
Collin still working from the windup. Payoff pitch. Up high. Walk the 9-hole guy.
Advantage Grace.
Yep.
Got the leadoff guy up. Third time through the order.
So. It's just crazy. It seems like sometimes they just have guys like that that you just cannot get out, and you kind of wonder why. And
Sometimes, most of the times, because you relax when the 9-hitter's up.
Yep.
And
can't do that right now. Not in a game like this. Pick off. Not in time. Maximo De Leon steps up. He's 0-for-2. He's grounded out to both the shortstop and the third baseman. Collin delivers. First pitch strike.
You know, all the things that you work on in this game and practice, and it boils down to things like being able to throw a strike to the 9-hitter. You know, it.
Pitch up too tall.
It's almost a pitch out.
Yeah, kind of looked that way. Hickman does have decent speed over at first. Collin delivers. That's down low. I feel like both ways, maybe the strike zone's tightened up a bit. And that's for both sides, I feel like. Collin throws over to first. Back
in
time.
We don't have the greatest of angles,
even though
we're right behind. It's tough to tell whether the ball's up or down.
Yeah. 2-1 on De Leon. Big lead from Hickman. He looks like he's ready to go, and he is. Swing and a miss. Hickman dives in safely. If he would have stayed on his feet, there's a chance he could have maybe thought about third, but it's a stolen base for him. And
yeah, Sebastian's just got in too big of a hurry.
Yep. So now a runner in scoring position. That's the first time since the first the Lancers have had someone pass first base. Really past the batter's box for that. 2-2. Hit up the middle. Deckman coming in, still coming in, dives, and able to make the grab, and that's a double play to end the inning. What an effort by Bryce Deckman to keep this game scoreless. Put a star next to that one, as Deckman may have just kept his team right in this ball game. The Foresters coming back up to the plate. Bottom of the sixth, still no runs for either side as we are stuck right in the middle of one of the better pitching duels you'll see all year long. It's Evan Etchison and Graham Collin battling it out. Tremendous performance by both of those guys. Cade Flores will lead it off. He sees a first pitch breaking ball in there for a strike.
Yeah, Etchison has been just really, really good.
Very locked in, hitting his spots and starting to use that breaking ball, as we just saw there, more effectively as well. That was a fastball outside. It's 1-1. Etchison has not given up much. Two hits is all. Flores takes another one on the outside corner. It's 1-2. I can't tell you the exact starting time of this game, but I can tell you we haven't been playing all that long. If we're already in the bottom of the sixth, you know what time we started?
It was close to 3:45, I think.
So we're only an hour in, and I mean, you know, one of these teams scores a run here in the next inning and a half, it could be over as Flores stays alive. Do you prefer these games, or do you prefer more offense? As a baseball fan, coach?
I think there's something to be said by these type of games.
Yeah.
Where the game hinges on each at-bat or each defensive play. Pitchers are throwing strikes.
Flores hits it hard. See if it stays fair, and it's just foul. Just foul down the left field line. Yeah, I agree.
I mean, it's fun to see the ball fly out of the ballpark and all that when you score 19 runs, but that's typically not the game of baseball.
No. I think these are more fun, honestly. It's kind of on the edge of your seat. One swing can change it. One defensive play can change it. So it adds a little more to, like you said, each at-bat, each play. That's up and out. Flores putting together a really nice at-bat. See if Cade can get on. He's got some wheels. Yeah, and then Deckman, a great bunter.
See who's going to win this pitch here.
Here's the pitch. That is called strike three on the outside corner.
You can't take that pitch. No, you just can't
today.
Do it. You're putting it in the umpire's hands. Can't do it.
Yeah, and it's an umpire that has had a generous zone in this game. So you got to be willing to stand up there and swing it. That time Flores goes down looking. That brings up Deckman, who pops the first pitch up to the right side. Over on it is Hickman, who settles under it and is able to make the catch roaming backwards. That's a one pitch out. And now that brings up Nolasco Baroa. Baroa here in game two had the first hit of the afternoon for the Foresters his last time up. He's 1-for-2. He's hit the ball pretty hard both times. See if that trend continues as he takes the first pitch down too low for a ball. We talked about how great Baroa played in that first game. He needs to find a way on here. It's called a strike. 1-1. Etchison delivers. Hit hard again, and that's another great swing by Baroa. If you can take one positive from the offensive performance in this game, it's that Baroa's been locked in here in the first game, and now in game two, he's got two of the three knocks.
Now, it'd be interesting to see if Gregory runs here at some point. You got your three hitter at the plate.
Yeah.
Etchison is going to spend a lot of time with him over there based on what he did with Dylan last inning.
Mm-hmm. Etchison, just like you said, throws over. He is not going to allow any Forester base runner to get a decent lead. He's trying to keep them as close as possible. I would like to see him run here, I think. I think try to push it a little bit. You got your big guys coming up in the next inning. I guess we'll see. That being said, would they? I don't think they'd walk Wolf to get to Malott.
No, they wouldn't.
That's up and out. Maybe
that's almost like a pitch out.
Yep, spot on.
I don't know. I would want to give Wolf an opportunity to swing the bat.
Yeah.
Maybe as the count gets deeper, as the at-bat gets deeper, maybe give him a chance to run. But early.
Well, they're going through some of the signs here. It's a 1-1 count. Just saw a breaking ball. There's another throw over. You got to be heads up as a base runner over at first today. Etchison throws over. I bet he's thrown over 10 to 12 times.
Yeah. Well, once again, I get back to this game from Huntington's standpoint. It's going to hinge on whether they can hit the ball away.
Yep. Big secondary, big swing and a miss. 1-2.
Now I think you're probably looking for Greg to run here.
Yep. Another throw over. He's back in time. Wolf waits for Etchison. Evan sets from the waist. Alaska Baroa dives back in. 0-0, bottom of the sixth, two outs. Three-hole hitter Matt Wolf at the plate. Graham Collin and Evan Etchison going back and forth. Here's the pitch. Not going that time. It does kick away, so that's as good as a steal. As that'll go as either a pass ball or a wild pitch. Either way, it puts a runner in scoring position. And now the Foresters maybe just a hit away from taking the lead.
Yeah, I think that's a wild pitch because I think it was in the dirt or in the turf, I should say, before it got to the catcher.
And you got to think that Barroa being a good base runner over there, forcing those throws over, that takes focus off the hitter at the plate a little bit. So maybe that, you know, wild pitch, pass ball, you know, probably was a wild pitch, like you said, leads to that. Wolf through the right side. The wave is on. Here comes the throw from the right fielder Hickman. It's on the money, but not in time as Barroa dives in safely and the Foresters have a 1-0 lead.
Boy, that was a great throw, a great attempt at a tag, but an even better slide by Gregory. And I don't know whether you noticed, but Jordan Malott is up there telling him where to slide. And that is so crucial in that situation.
You talked about it all afternoon. One of these Foresters is going to have to decide to hit the ball to the right side. Yep. Matt Wolf has done it twice, and he just had the biggest hit of this series as he drives it through the right side. And now look at how big that wild pitch is, because you're not looking at a run.
Yeah, no doubt.
So
no doubt.
Crucial, crucial piece of hitting. He is the guy that you have said all year long you want at the plate in a big scenario, and he just keeps delivering. Really impressive.
I think in key situations, for me, you throw stats out the window. I want my biggest competitor at the plate. And that's who Matt is.
Yeah.
He's a big-time competitor. And
now Huntington in the driver's seat with their ace on the bump. If you're looking ahead to the next inning, it is 2-3-4 for Grays. So, of course, H.U. would love to add on one more or two more. But
yeah. Grace has got guys coming to the plate that can certainly, you know, turn a one-run deficit into a lead.
Yep.
So this thing is far from over.
But
now, would I like to have a one-run lead going to the last inning? Yeah.
Yeah.
With my ace on the mound?
Yes.
Yeah, I would.
That's what I'm saying. At least you know you have it. But if Jordan Malott can add maybe one more, you feel really good. There's some big-time at-bats from Barroa and Wolf coming up for their team.
Yeah, definitely.
Etchison with the pitch to Malott. Drops in a breaking ball for a called strike.
See, that's the pitch right there that I think with no strikes you take. But it's probably going to have to be a pitch you're going to have to hit the other way before your at-bat is over.
This one's hit up the middle. That's down. Wolf being waved around third. He's going to score easily as De Leon hits the cutoff man, and the Foresters' offense has come alive in the seventh. They lead 2-0.
That's a big hit. That's a big hit.
Yeah, talk about production from the middle of this lineup. You get your guys up that you want up, and they deliver three straight singles. Foresters up 2-0 with Cam Clarkson stepping to the plate.
So Parker is running at first base.
Richards will run at first.
Be interesting to see if they run here.
He's got a decent lead. Here's the pitch. Got a good secondary, but backs back to the bag.
Yeah, left-handed hitter up, which is going to protect him a little bit. Catchers would prefer to throw with a right-handed hitter up there because you don't have a possible obstruction with your throwing if that hitter's in the right-hand box.
There he goes, fouled straight back. I tell you, Clarkson had a good swing at that
one. Yeah, good swing. And now I think you'd be real aggressive.
Yeah.
You're up two runs. I think you'd be real aggressive here.
Try to find a way to get a third, and you feel great about your odds. Clarkson 0-2. He throws back over to first, that being Etchison. Richards was maybe leaning a bit, but dove back in time. I think you're right. I think they're going to kind of put the foot on the pedal here. I think Richards might be off again. At that same lead. There he goes. Good jump. Throw down to second is in time, but missed the tag on the backside, and Richards is in there safely.
That's a good slide. Good slide. Sliding to the center field side of second base. just able to get in under the tag. The ball beat him.
Yeah.
But the throw is up and towards right field. So.
See if Clarkson now can deliver. 2-1 pitch. Hit hard to the right side. Clarkson's got a single. Hickman coming up on it again. He's going to fire it towards home. It's not cut off. Richards is across, sliding head first, and it's a 3-0 advantage as the Foresters bats have woken up here in the sixth inning.
Boy, just some really good at-bats this inning. Baroa, Matt Wolf, especially hitting the ball backside. Jordy hitting the ball through the middle. And then Cam hitting the ball really hard to right field. Just really really good at-bats here.
Yeah, four straight singles with two outs, too. So all of this being done.
Wow, Jonathan Baker running at first base.
Okay, that's a little different.
Yeah, Baker's a great athlete. Yeah. He really is. He came here to play short and pitch.
Really?
And decided just to pitch.
Yeah.
And, no, he can run.
So
he can definitely run.
The rare relief pitcher.
I don't think he's
going to
steal here, yeah. But he can run.
Hey, never know, all right? Ross steps up. It's now a 3-0 advantage for HU. Dylan takes first pitch breaking ball in there for a strike. I think if you're a Lancer fan, you're going to look at Etchison's line and think he didn't pitch as well as he really did. I mean, I thought he was pretty dynamite today, and the Foresters just put together four good at-bats in a row.
Well, the problem is you messed up against Graham Collin, who's arguably one of the better pitchers in the league. So your margin of error is not real strong.
Yep.
Or not real big, because Graham's not going to give up a whole lot.
No. Or anything.
I mean, he gave up four runs last week at Goshen, and people are like, what?
Yep.
So.
Etchison.
Etchison has thrown the ball well.
He has.
He's got a pattern he wants to stick with, and he's done a good job with that. I've been impressed. I've not seen him throw since high school, and very impressed with him.
Yeah, he's got really good stuff.
The thing I like about him is he competes. You know, he has a little bit of an edge to him as he's throwing. He's got good stuff, a good approach, and then he competes.
Here's the pitch. Check swing from Ross. Steal is on, and how about that? Maybe not a steal, but a dirt ball read, and Baker's in diving head first.
Yeah, he wants everybody to know about it now, doesn't he? That's a great read.
It is just
a great read. That's what you teach, you know, your guys to do, and for Bake to come off the bench and do that, that's big.
It is, because now you got another runner in scoring position. If Ross can sneak another one into the outfield, probably looking at a 4-0 lead. Pitch down too low. And that's something you can teach your guys, but until you get into a game scenario, it's also kind of a reaction play and read the ball down.
Yeah,
Baker doesn't run the bases a lot.
You got to read the ball out of the hand.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of times you don't look to move up on a ball in the dirt unless it's a breaking ball, because you can read the breaking ball out of the hand, the downward motion, and you can read that it's not going to get to the plate. Fastball, it's tougher to do that. And so, but that's a really good read. I'm impressed.
Ross takes a breaking ball right down the middle. That's strike three called, but the Foresters finally break out the bats. Four straight singles with two outs has HU up 3-0. Graham Collin trying to finish the job. Welcome back to Forest Glen Park. The Foresters are up 3-0 as we head into the bottom of the seventh, top of the seventh, I should say. And the last inning here in game number two of this doubleheader, Graham Collin, just three outs away from another complete game, and he has not allowed a hit in this ball game as he delivers first pitch strike. I'm not one to believe in the jinx, so.
Yeah, I'm not either.
I guess we'll see. Now, if he gets a hit right here, I won't say it again.
If he gets a hit here, the switchboard is going to light up to get Preston and yeah. Coach Frame off of the yep. broadcast.
We won't be back. It's 0-2 on Friesma. He's 0-2. Graham, ready to roll. That's fouled away, especially if he gives up that one.
Well, it's going to be tough because Grace is going to put the ball in play.
Yes, absolutely.
They're going to battle, and you never know when one of those on turf, you know, sneaks through the infield.
Yep. 0-2, up too high. Friesma taking a little extra time. Collin from the windup delivers. Breaking ball, swing and a miss, and now just two outs away. That breaking ball, you talked about in pregame. Off air, we said that, well, you said that Collin's got to find that slider, curveball, whatever he calls it, for a strike, and he has today.
That's what I thought against Goshen. He didn't have real good command on. I wasn't there. I was just watching him,
yeah.
You know.
This Uh-oh. One's up the middle. Flores going to have to make a great play. Instead, it's the second baseman, and not in time there from Paulina, as that is going to be an infield single, and there goes the no-hitter.
Yep, I guess we did jinx him.
Yep, we sure did. So now, Danforth with the first hit of the afternoon.
Now that that's out of the way, let's get a ground ball at somebody here and go home.
Yep.
But, Grace, these guys can swing it in the middle.
Yeah, they sure can. Trying to look back at my score book. I think that Grace has only hit two balls out of the infield in this game today.
Wow.
The diving play from Deckman. And then there was a line out to Rost. No, excuse me. Nolasco Baroa back in the third. That's it. Ground ball left side, and now back-to-back hits. And they're going to bring up the tying run to the plate.
And a guy that's already hit a home run today.
Sure is. It's Hartley. So it makes things a little interesting here with Hartley coming up. And that's going to bring a, looks like, not a pitching change, but a little meeting on the mound with Graham Collin. Okay, I guess we'll never bring that up again, Coach. It is a real thing. We will not bring up the no-hitter anymore.
Well, I always thought it was in the
dugout. Oh, yeah. In the dugout instead of on the broadcast
booth. Yeah, you don't bring it up in the dugout. But.
Either way, at this point, Huntington just wants the win.
Yeah, and this is a good hitter. He's going to be a really tough out.
Take a look and see really quick if we can check out some scores around the Crossroads League. Try to pull up the schedule here. St. Francis beat Goshen in game one today. Marion beat Bethel. Indiana Wesleyan just finished up game one with Taylor. 18-17 final score.
Wow.
Graham from the stretch delivers down low to Hartley. Mount Vernon beat Spring Arbor. And then, of course, Huntington beat Grace.
Yeah, I think that Spring Arbor, Mount Vernon game, when I saw it, Spring Arbor was ahead. So.
Here's the pitch. Check swing, called strike. Looked like he went anyways. It's 1-1. Yeah, Mount Vernon beat Spring Arbor 10-7. Then in the game twos around the conference, Goshen and St. Francis tied at twos. Indiana Wesleyan Taylor just underway. Marion beating Bethel 4-1. Collins pitch, swing and a miss again. Hartley.
That's a good changeup.
Yeah, a little
That's
awkward swing.
Really good changeup. Had him way out in front. Now it's 0-2 and it or 1-2, and in his mind he's, okay, what am I going to get here?
Colin from the stretch drops one in too low. It's 2-2. Almost looked like he went back to that changeup, maybe.
Yeah, I think he did.
Forrester's just two outs away, taking the first two in this four-game set. Hartley takes inside. It's full. Do not want to walk this guy.
No.
Graham Collin sets from the waist. His pitch is hit to the right side. Paulina backs up on it, goes to second, and a big pick by Flores. That could have been a lot more dangerous there, but it is a good play by Flores to get the man out at second base.
I don't know if I'd just rather him go to first base.
I agree.
Next guy gets a hit, it doesn't beat you. You're still ahead 3-2.
Yep, totally agree.
So
that was close, but it's an out.
But that's a big out. He made a good pitch there. Was that a breaking ball?
I think so.
Because Papp got him out on a breaking ball in the first game on a 3-2 count.
Yep.
Yeah.
So that brings up Ryan Stark. Still the tying run. Forrester's just an out away now. Yeah, I kind of thought Paulina had his body going towards first. Yeah. Maybe just get the... Either way, I mean, it's a good pick by Flores because that could have bounced away anywhere. Now Stark lifts one into center field. That drops down in front of Deckman. That's the first run of the day for the Lancers, and now it's 3-1. So Grace at least making it interesting. You said they're going to put the ball in play, and they have.
Yep. Well, think about that. That pick at second base from Flores to get the second out, that doesn't happen. Now you're big time trouble.
Yeah. That ball could have skipped away from him. There could have been runners going everywhere. I mean, that could have been real dangerous. Now stands in Sean Gannon, and Sebastian Coons wants Graham to step off, and he does. Now he'll restart the process. Collin from the stretch delivers. First pitch strike, fastball in the outside corner. Gannon in this game is 0-2. Strikeout and a pop out. The pitch down low. Nice block there by Coons. Especially if that ball gets by him, you've now got two runners in scoring position, maybe just a single away from tying it.
Yeah.
Everything matters in these games, just like you said. Keeping those runners 90 feet further away from home, I guess you could say. Ground ball left side, deep in the hole. Flores bobbles it, doesn't have a play, and now the bases are loaded. Getting interesting. Probably go as a single. And that'll bring up Callaway.
Yeah, I think Cade's only play there was maybe a play at third base, but then when he bobbled the ball, that really took that off the table.
Yep. So it looks like Coach Roth wants to speak with his base runners and hitters. Obviously, you don't get many more situations as crucial as this. The tying runner now up to second base. The go-ahead run is on first. Collin at 95 pitches, and to be honest, until this inning, it was pretty smooth sailing for Graham. And now, just like that, Grace has a chance to tie it or take the lead in the top of the seventh. That's another ball, by the way, that did not leave the infield. I mean, they've hit a lot of infield singles. They've had a lot of choppers that have kind of gone for hits here in this game. So Graham's not getting hit hard. It's just getting hit in the wrong spot.
Yeah, really, the base hit to center field was the hardest ball that they've hit. But, hey, it doesn't matter.
Yep. All right.
Does not matter.
Collin's got to buckle up here. Callaway's the hitter. First pitch lined into left field. They're going to test the arm of the left fielder. Here comes the throw from Nolasco Baroa. It's on the money, and it's not in time. It's dropped by Coons at the plate. I think they had him out. It was a perfect throw from Baroa, and Coons just could not hang on, and that ties this game up at 3. Wow. So just like the Foresters did, Grace rallies late. They've tied it up, and they're not done yet. As Collin delivers first pitch, breaking ball in there, a strike on Hickman. All singles have led to this comeback. That's down low. It's 1-1. Graham, the righty, sets and delivers. Swing and a miss. Now if you're Graham, you just want to keep him right here, give your team a chance to walk it off.
Yeah.
In the bottom of the 7th. Definitely frustrating, though, for Collin.
But Huntington's got 7, 8, 9 up.
Yep.
So, and a couple of those guys are not a good matchup against Etchison.
Fly ball to the right side. Ross back towards the wall, right at the line, able to make the catch. And that'll send us to the bottom of the 7th. We're all tied up. It's a new game. Foresters come to the plate. Bottom of the 7th, it is 3-3 after a 2-out rally by both teams. And their most previous at-bats have locked us back up. For a long time it was 0-0, now it's 3-3, and it's Sebastian Coons who will lead things off against Evan Etchison. And Etchison has to feel like he's been given a second chance at life here to be pitching the bottom of the 7th. First pitch to Coons, up too high. Got to start getting some production from these guys at the bottom.
Yep.
See if Coons can do that. Second pitch. Inside 2-0. Are you taking here? Like, is that something you're thinking as a coach?
Yeah, I probably am here.
Take till you get a strike, maybe?
With the hitter who's up here, I'm probably going to ask him to take a pitch here.
We'll see. He does, and it's down low. Now you're definitely taking.
Yeah.
And then you're probably running for him as well, correct?
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Etchison gets the sign. Down too low. Wow. 4-pitch walk.
Boy,
wow.
I didn't see that coming.
Me either. Okay, let's see who they choose. Looks like...
probably Parker.
Yeah, looks like it is Parker again.
Nope. Nope, it's not. It's,
I got to go through my roster.
I didn't see the number.
Jonathan Roach.
Oh, okay.
So he's coming in, a freshman from Bishop Luers right down the road. I still don't have everyone memorized. In basketball, it's a little easier, but in baseball, there's a lot of guys out there.
Yeah, I think Parker ran for somebody else.
He
earlier,
did.
Yeah.
You're right.
Well, I think you bunt here.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And then I don't know if they walk Cade to pitch to Deckman because it's a Cade hits left-handed against the righty Etchison.
They do have one guy warming up.
Yeah, I was trying to see if is he warming up quickly or
I don't think necessarily all that quickly.
Either that or he's already loose and he's just kind of waiting. I don't know.
It looks like that's number one for Grace. Which, once again, going to have to pull up my roster here, make sure we got everyone's names correct. If that is indeed one, that is Owen Kirkenstein, right-handed pitcher from Tippecanoe Valley, Danville Area Community College transfer. Mm. So we'll see. They're sticking with Etchison now. Here comes the bunt attempt. It's a ball. Got to be careful over at first. And it looked like the catcher Gannon maybe thought it should have been called a strike, but
yeah,
it wasn't.
He wasn't real happy with that call.
No. Sometimes it does, I think, distract the umpire when someone's trying to bunt and it pulls away quickly. They almost, not necessarily lose focus, but miss a pitch or two in those situations.
Well, in that situation, you teach your catchers, you're probably not going to field the bunt.
Yeah.
So stay back, stay down, because it's probably going to be the third baseman or the pitcher.
Correct.
That's going to field the bunt.
Etchison sets. The pitch. The bunt's down to the left side. They may have had a chance at second. Now they don't have a chance at all as it's bobbled. That's an E5. And maybe just putting that extra pressure on added to that as now it's runners on first and second. Huntington gifted a chance there.
Well, I would assume that you'll bunt here.
Yeah.
And then I don't know if they'll walk Deckman to load the bases for Baroa. I don't know. That's a tough situation.
It sure is. Either way, it's a good situation for the Foresters now. I mean,
yeah, because if they get the bunt down, then the infielders have to come in.
Yep.
You got no other choice.
Let's see. Flores does square, and he puts it down to the left side. Etchison goes to third. Nice play by him. Not
why
sure.
You don't have to tag him.
Callaway was tagging, but he did, and that's an out.
Just
and
a bad bunt.
Yep.
Not executing the game.
That's a fielder's choice.
Now the advantage goes back to Grace.
Correct. Coons, well, not Coons cut down, but his pinch runner.
So they're making a
out.
Change here.
Yeah.
Wow, that's real interesting.
Yeah, they're going to go away from their ace, and they're going to go from a different righty. We already told you it's number one, Owen Kirkenstein, 1-0 with a 7.5 ADRA, 10 appearances, just 19 innings. And that's who Coach Ryan Roth is going to go with. We're going to take a short break. We'll come right back, see if the Foresters can walk it off. Back here at Forest Glen Park, bottom of the seventh, the final inning of game number two of the doubleheader. At least it's supposed to be. Maybe playing extra innings here. I guess we'll see. It's a new pitcher on the mound, Owen Kirkenstein. The righty will step in the place of Etchison, who threw a really nice game out there. Got through 6 1/3, made a nice play on the mound there against Cade Flores. Huntington flips the lineup over, and it's Bryce Deckman, who's hitless here in game number two. A hit this time around may walk it off.
Well, you definitely have speed on the bases with Paco at second and Cade at first.
First pitch, big lead out on second. Ball outside on the fastball. Paulina, good speed at second. Once again, he's picked off on the backside. Paco now in a rundown. Ball thrown into the turf.
Get to the bag, Cade.
Cade goes back. Paulina is picked off. And
backside runner, you've got to get to second base because they're going to get the front side runner out. So you at least still have a guy in scoring position.
Not the best baseball there by the Foresters.
No,
that was back-to-back plays.
That was not very good at all.
Not sure where Paco's even thinking about going at the moment. That is a head scratcher, and kind of just leave the just kind of letting the reliever off the hook a little bit as well before he even has to deliver more than one pitch.
Just trying to do too much.
Yep.
Try to do too much with the bunt. Try to do too much with the base running.
Here's the pitch, Deckman.
Well, they had already looked like they were going to go to second to pick Paco the first pitch.
Yeah.
And they didn't. So it should not have been a surprise what they were doing.
I agree. Pitch. There goes the runner Flores. Deckman's hit by the pitch. And so now runners on first and second again, but it could have been bases loaded with one out. So you hope either way the Foresters find a way to win, but definitely some things to work on or teach once again, even though these things have been taught countless times before.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, they've been taught, talked about these things and just have not executed.
Nope. It's not been crisp to end this game for HU, but a win cures a lot of things. I know everyone still might not be happy with how the game played out, but you win a game, you go up 2-0 in the series, and you still feel good about that.
Yeah, no doubt.
So we'll see. Here's the pitch. Barroa takes up high. And what I am, I guess, most confused about is Paulina getting picked off. You haven't even seen if this kid can deliver a strike yet.
Yeah.
And right now he's showing that he's struggling with that.
Yeah, no doubt.
Kirkenstein sets from the stretch and delivers. That time he finds the zone. It's 2-1.
And I'm assuming that Thad does not have him running in that situation.
I wouldn't think so.
But my point with Cade is once that guy's picked off, you've got to get to second base.
Yep. There comes another pickoff play. That time a diving stop by Carr keeps it in the infield.
Because you give up the out between second and third, but you get the base at second, which you're in scoring position now. Instead of you're 15 feet away from the bag at second and you go back to first.
Oh, called strike.
Wow.
That's an interesting time to widen up the zone. That was way out of the zone. Catcher was down on his knee to receive that baseball. So Barreau is going to have to battle with two. Kirkenstein sets. Here's the pitch. Roa swings at one in the dirt. He's tagged out, and that ends the threat. So we head to extras. To the top of the eighth we go. We'll see who's on the mound for the Foresters when we come back. Thank you. Back here for extra innings. Some free baseball for the fans here at Huntington University as we head to the eighth. Graham Collin will work into his eighth inning right at 100 pitches. And he'll be taking on, the leadoff man, Maximo De Leon, to start this eighth inning.
Yeah, I think advantage goes to Grace now with the top of the order up, seeing Graham for the fourth time. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, and you don't want to see this guy get on because he's a speedster. Can really wreak havoc on the base paths. That's a good pitch in there.
Huntington's had a chance to win this game twice.
Yep.
And they haven't done it, so that's concerning.
Up and out. 2-1. De Leon has not been on here in game two. 0-3. Collin delivers. Breaking ball lifted to left field. It's deep, but it's playable. Back on it goes Barroa. Camps under it. One-hand catch. And it's an out. As that is a big first out here to retire the leadoff man, as now Friesma will step up to the plate.
It's an out. It's not a very fundamental out, but it's an out. So
I knew you wouldn't like that as soon as I saw him catch it. Oh, Friesma, the righty, stands in. Collin works out of the windup. Delivers pitch number 105. It's a breaking ball up top for a ball, 1-0. Danforth is up next. He's got a lot of pop. There is an arm getting loose in the bullpen for HU. That's up high again. It's 2-0.
I think that's Oxley down there. Just from looking at his throwing style.
I think that's a good guess. Collins pitch out of the zone, 3-0.
I think Graham's getting tired. He's not finishing pitches. He's jerking pitches a little bit.
3-0, called a strike. Yeah, that's, over 105 pitches now.
Yeah, I would say it gets through this inning. That's probably it for the day.
That's a walk. And now that brings up Danforth, who is a dangerous hitter. Then Carr to follow. That's Collins' second walk of the day. He's got 6 strikeouts through 7 1/3. 3 earned runs. Pickoff throws down the line. Malott's going to have to get to this in a hurry, and he does to keep the runner at second base, but it's a throwing error on Graham, and that moves the go-ahead runner into scoring position. Not been the cleanest of couple of innings. Now Graham's really got to settle in and find a way to get out of this inning. His pitch. Breaking ball hit right up the middle. Deckman had a read on it, had to back off. That's going to push the go-ahead runner to third. It's a single for Danforth, and now runners on the corner. Danforth, I should say, with just one out. This is one that Huntington would look back on if they cannot find a way to win and be extremely irritated at how this game played out.
Well, there's definitely some things, mistakes that they've made, not things that they don't work on, they don't talk about, but they just don't execute.
Yep.
And if they don't learn how to execute those things, to be real honest, their season's going to be over quickly.
Yeah.
You're not going to win in the tournament making some of these mistakes. You've got the Goshen game that you let a 5-run lead go in the last inning. You've got this game.
Mount Vernon.
Yeah, it's 2 outs, 3-0. You can't close it out. Mount Vernon, 3 outs. You can't close it out. And today it hasn't been the relief pitching. It's just been kind of questionable mistakes, base running, bunting, you know, some of those kinds of things. And so now you're hoping for a ground ball hit at somebody that you might be able to turn a double play.
Yep. It's Carr, the second baseman. Collin sets and delivers. They're looking to bunt, and it's fouled straight back. So maybe trying to stay out of that ground ball double play is what Coach
Well, I think
Rob
they had a
thinking.
safety squeeze on. The best time to run that is with the runner at first. You really can't defend it. Because if you bunt it hard to first base, the first baseman can't leave early. And so it's almost, you know, like Bryce Deckman we had against Taylor, I think. You can't defend it.
Here's the pitch, looking to do it again. It's to the pitcher, though. Collin bobbles it, and he's not going to have a play anywhere. Tried to be too quick, didn't work out. And that's the first lead of the day for Grace College, and that's going to be the end of the day for Graham Collin. Extremely frustrating end to his afternoon. He had a no-hitter through 6 1/3, and right now he's walking out in line for a loss in this ball game. So it'll be, we believe, Adam Oxley coming in. We'll see for sure when we come back. Back here at Forest Glen Park, top of the eighth, and for the first time this afternoon, Grace College has the lead. It's Adam Oxley, the first relief pitcher of the day in both games for Huntington, and he's got a job to do, and that's keep this just a one-run game. Grace has stormed back in this game to take this lead, and they've been gifted some runs as well. Bullpen has been a question mark for HU. It's got to be solid right now. The pitch. Swing and a miss. Looks like this might be a new hitter. It's Gavin Kelly in to hit for Hartley. It's interesting. Hartley's been pretty solid at the plate today. Kelly lifts one right side. I don't know if anyone's going to have a play. Malott roams over. And
is Hartley who hit the home run?
Yeah. Huh. That's what I'm a little confused about. Because this would be Hartley's spot. He's number 22, bats left-handed. This is Gavin Kelly.
Huh. Oh. That is interesting.
Yeah. And he's the DH position, so you don't have to worry about flipping anything there. I don't know if they ran for him, and maybe when you run for the DH position, do you have to switch it out?
Yeah. Well, you can't re-enter the DH
so
position.
So I wonder if that's why both runners are off, and there's no play for Coons, as that's a double steal. Now both runners in scoring position, and Oxley's got to find a way to get an out here without giving up a run. I think the infield might come in as well. They will. They're going to try to cut down any run at the plate. Oxley sets and delivers. Down too low. It's now 2-2. Sets again and pitches. That's outside, and now it's full. It's gone from 0-2 to 3-2.
Yeah, you go to 3-2. Now the advantage is for the hitter, because I'm assuming, well, they got a base open, so maybe they could still use different pitches here.
It's a fastball, I believe, right on the inside corner. I couldn't tell if that's what he went with.
Yeah, that was a fastball.
But it was a good one, and it's a big out because that keeps us a one-run game at the moment. And now Stark will step up. Of course, he had a big hit his last time up. He knocked in a run and then came around to score the game-tying run in the last inning. Swing and a miss. And he did it on the first pitch in that first at-bat as well. So he's ready to swing. Look at who Huntington has coming up ahead. It's Wolf, Malott, Clarkson. So the big hitters again. But right now, Oxley's got to keep it just a one-run game, and he's up 0-2 in the count. Oxley sets and delivers. Breaking ball up top, swing and a miss. And that will end the threat, and that will send us to the bottom of the eighth. The Foresters will need one, two. We'll win it when we come back. Welcome back to FDN Sports. We've made it to the bottom of the eighth. Extra innings here between the Grace Lancers and the Huntington Foresters. Huntington needs at least one. Two will win it. And they've got the middle of the lineup coming up. Matt Wolf, first to step in, is facing Owen Kirkenstein, who's come on in relief, retired two batters, kind of get out of a jam. Wolf nearly wears the first pitch. Malott waits on deck.
Oxley did a good job coming in and getting the strikeout with the runner at third and one out. And
he
then
did.
Got the strikeout to close it out. That, you know, keeps Grace within striking, or Huntington within striking distance.
Yeah, it gives you a real chance here in this inning. Wolf has had two really good at-bats his last two times up. His shot singles to the right side. That one's up high. He's up in the count 2-1. the shadows may start playing a little bit of a role. I don't know if it's going to affect them too much, but some shadows kind of sneaking out in front of the hitters. Wolf's up 3-1. And maybe it won't. But that's something hitters talk about as well.
He gets on base. I'm not sure the bunt's going to be in order with Jordan.
Yeah, I don't think so. Pitch. Wolf hits it high in the air left field. Going back, Danforth is underneath it. Danforth, excuse me, I messed his name up, but he makes the grab. And that's a fly ball out. And now Huntington's just down to two more outs to work with. I feel like Wolf maybe just missed that. But, as you talked about, lifting the ball a lot recently. It's up to Jordan Mellott now, and then looks like a pinch hitter Ryan Wheeler waits on deck. Pitch. Mellott takes in there for a strike.
Something must be wrong with Cam's thumb if they're taking him out in this situation.
I would think so, too. Pitch is in there again for a strike. So Mellott's quickly down 0-2. Kirkenstein sets and delivers from the stretch. Hit to the left side hard. Handled by Friesma. He makes a perfect throw over, and it's two up, two down, and now Huntington's down to their final out. And it's going to be Ryan Wheeler instead of Cam Clarkson. So Wheeler did homer in game number one. Actually leads the team in average. See if he can provide a spark off the bench. If not, this will be a quality comeback win for the Lancers and one that Huntington will not soon forget. Pitch popped up straight back behind home plate and no play available for Gannon. It's 0-1. Kirkenstein sets and will deliver. Fouled straight back. Home plate umpire going to need a minute as it's 0-2. It's a tough job back there behind home plate. Coach Roth trying to check on the home plate man to make sure everything's all good. Also, one of the trainers from Huntington. Huntington will be back in town on Monday playing two home games against the Grace Lancers. If they don't find a way to win this one, definitely want to find a way to win those next two, if possible, to secure a series win.
I don't think that there's any way Huntington can lose two on Monday and still have a thought of, you know, finishing in the top two or the top three. I just think that's going to be really difficult if they don't do that.
Yep, I agree. The pitch, Wheeler fouls it away. Still 0-2. And with you know, you look at Iwoo beating Taylor in that first game, that pulled Huntington closer to the top as well. And now this could bump them right back. Wheeler pops it up to the right side. See if it's playable. Not much room down there, and it runs out of room as Hickman was giving it a chase and couldn't quite get there. So Rhines fouled a few pitches off. He turned on one in game one. If he can do it here, at least tie it up. 0-2 pitch. Wheeler takes just outside. Looks like a pretty good pitch.
Yeah, I don't know how you take that pitch. I thought it looked like it was on the plate.
Me too.
We got a good angle from, because he's a left-handed hitter.
1-2. Wheeler's hit. So that keeps the inning alive. Now Dylan Ross steps up. now. You're going to run for Wheeler. And is this
Carter Wagner?
Yeah.
Another pitcher running.
Yeah. All kind of things going on. So Carter Walker on to run. Out of Santa Claus, Indiana. I mean, you got to think a lot of these guys were probably two position players in high school.
Yeah.
So they're not
clueless. You're right. You go to a Little League game, the best player pitches and plays shortstop.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you're right.
But for some of them, it's been a while since they've been on the base paths. Here's the pitch. Ross takes that same breaking ball he's seen really this entire second game for a strike.
So, Carter, run to that white thing in front of you and turn left, right?
And keep going until they tell you to stop. Here's the pitch. Another breaking ball. That one's outside. They are breaking ball heavy on Ross right now.
Well, we talked about that. You know, got to make an adjustment.
1-1 pitch. That's a fastball. Dotted for a strike. 1-2. For the second time this inning, Huntington down to their final strike. Kirkenstein delivers. Ross pops it up. See if someone's got a play. They're going to have to go over the brick wall if they do, and they do just that to make the grab. And that will end the ball game. Huntington blows a 3-0 lead. In the very last inning, Graham Collin couldn't quite finish the job, and then the offense struggled at the end. They tie today's doubleheader 1-1, and the Foresters and the Lancers will meet again on Monday, and it feels like if you're Grace, you kind of snuck out of here with one, and if you're Huntington, you thought you should have got both. So frustrating day at the ballpark for the Foresters for sure.
Yeah, I mean, obviously our hearts are with Huntington, but you know, you got to give credit to Grace and a lot of good things that they did. They basically owned the last two innings.
Yeah.
And Huntington has, as we talked, has struggled to put teams away, and once again, it's another day where they struggled to put teams away. And this day wasn't so much the relief pitching. It was base running, offensive execution, and the fact that you just couldn't get Grace out, you know. Yeah. And we got your Crossroads League Pitcher of the Year on the mound, and he can't get them out. So that's credit goes to them. So and Huntington has put themselves behind the eight ball. I don't know that if they want a shot to win the league, I don't know that they can lose anymore.
Yeah.
And I know that's tough with 10 games left, but and four of those against Indiana Wesleyan, but that's just reality.
Yep.
If you don't want to be in that position, then, you know, play better.
Yeah.
So that's the way it is.
It's
so
definitely a season they'll look back on and count up the losses of games they probably should have won. And this was probably another one you'd put in that category. So it's frustrating, but it is baseball.
This is what, the sixth game that they've lost where they've taken at least a 3-run lead to the last inning.
Yep.
So that's frustrating.
It is. Well, Coach, thanks for joining us again today. We'll hop off the headset here, and I think Thad's going to come up and join us, chat about that day of baseball, and then I'm assuming you and I will be back to work here again on Monday afternoon.
Sounds good. I'll be here.
All right. Thanks, Coach.
Yep.